people have asked that. Wouldn't it be cool if the choir sang a song about rising up? And proclaims, happy are those who walk in the way of the Lord and who seek God with their whole hearts. Joining our voices with all who seek to walk humbly with God, let us call ourselves to worship this morning using the words printed in your bulletin. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear?
The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear.
Though war rise up against me, yet I will be confident.
I invite you all now to stand as you are able and join together in singing our opening hymn of the morning, hymn number 457, I greet thee who my sure Redeemer art.
Thank you.
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we gather today to celebrate your presence in the lives of all your faithful people. Send your Spirit to meet us here today and guide us into your depths that we may begin to glimpse your grace. What eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor human heart conceived, all that you have prepared for those who love you. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus, your mystery, your wisdom, your glory, and the one who taught us all to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you all now to greet those sitting around you with the peace of Christ. Welcome to Buford Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you are all here with us. This morning, we extend a special greeting to those that are visiting with us. We hope that you find this to be a warm place to worship and a place where you know and experience God's presence in your midst this day. Want to invite you to be sure to read through your bulletin at some point today. There's a number of announcements about things taking place in the life of our congregation, as well as the schedule of activities of things happening here this week. But I'm going to call a few of those to your attention at this time. Today is the day that we celebrate the Super Bowl, and here in Atlanta, we hope that the Falcons will rise up later this evening. I know everybody, I see everybody in their red and black, and so we're excited about the Super Bowl. But today here in worship, we will also celebrate the Super Bowl of Caring. It began a number of years ago in a Presbyterian church with a youth group that prayed a prayer about folks not having even a bowl of soup to eat on the night that they were watching the Super Bowl together. And so this movement spread where youth have continued to collect money and canned goods on Super Bowl Sunday to be reminded that there are folks in our midst that do go without. And so we do our part to try and make a difference. So you will find our youth, they'll be telling you a little bit more about it in our children's sermon in just a few minutes, but you will find our youth standing at the doorways following our service holding soup pots. And so we invite you to give to that offering. This will be in lieu of our PATH offering. Our PATH offering, which is collected on the first Sunday of each month, goes largely to support the North Gwinnett Co-op, as will the Super Bowl of Caring offering that we'll collect this morning. So do be aware when you see our youth standing there with big soup pots that that's what they're there for. Want to invite you, if you have not already, to be sure that you get your tickets for our Valentine's catered lunch. Folks are out in the narthex and are able to get tickets for you. Today is the final day to purchase those tickets. We need to get information to the caterer for next Sunday. So next Sunday is our catered lunch, and that will happen immediately following this service over in the gym. We'll have that time together and a great meal as well. So enjoy. Invite invite you to come and join us for that fun and that fellowship and good food. So be sure to get your tickets following our service today out in the narthex. Want to go ahead and bring to your attention, this is sort of a save the date, that our vacation Bible school will be this year, the week of June 5th through the 9th. So go ahead and put that on your calendars. More information will be forthcoming from folks that are planning our vacation Bible school. But want to make sure you go ahead and get that date, June 5th through the 9th, on your calendar. Our first work day will be March the 18th. So those are a few dates just for you to be aware of. And as I said, more information will be forthcoming. In your bulletin, there's a number of announcements about groups that will be meeting this month, our PW circles. All of the information about their meetings are in your bulletin. Our men's prayer breakfast will meet next Saturday. We invite you as well to sign up for Suppers for Six. The sign up is in the Narthex. It's a great opportunity to meet folks that you might not already know in the congregation as you share meals together. And then as well, our Tired Mother's Getaway is March the 3rd through the 5th. So be aware of that date as well. And at this time, I'd like to invite Lynn Zahner to come and give us an announcement.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm wearing my running shoes today to remind me to invite you all to join our team in the Atlanta Community Food Bank 5K Walk Run for Hunger. And this will be taking place on Sunday, March 5th, which is the same weekend as the Tired Mothers weekend. So if you're not a tired mother, please come and join our team. The event will be at 2 p.m. at the Old Turner Field. And you may see some of these posters. It says, "Step up, stop hunger." I say, "Rise up, kick hunger, kick it through the goalposts, run it into the end zone, and then spike it."
Are there any other announcements that folks have this morning? Thank you. Thank you. Let us continue to worship God. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, or anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. These words from Paul remind us that nothing, no sin, no transgression is too great to be redeemed. And so before God and with the people of God, let us now confess our sins together. God of compassion, in Jesus Christ we see your transforming light, yet we continue to live in darkness, preoccupied with ourselves. We fail to see your hand at work in the world. We speak when we should listen and take action when we should wait. Empower us to live in your light and to walk in your ways for the sake of him who is the light of the world, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Hear now our silent prayers of confession. Thank you.
Amen.
Sisters and brothers, our sins are forgiven by the faith of Christ, who chose love over hatred and forgiveness over blame. Rejoice and be glad that God's mercy is great. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God, and amen. You may be seated. At this time, I would like to invite our children forward for our children's sermon this morning with several of our youth.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Can y'all tell me what tonight is? Okay. So I want everyone to raise your hand if you think the Patriots are going to win. Anybody? Okay. So why do you think the Patriots are going to win? They do have a good quarterback. Tom Brady's pretty good. Anybody else have any reasons why they're going to win? What's your reason? They have a good kicker. That's important, you know. You always need those. So now, who thinks the Falcons are going to win? That's good. So why do you think the Falcons are going to win?
Because I have faith in them.
Yeah, faith in them. That's good. Why do you think the Falcons are going to win? We have a good offensive line. Yes, you know football. That's a very good job. Very good. Okay, so who all is going to go to a party tonight? Or, you know, invite friends over and going to eat a lot of food, a lot of pizza, hot dogs, chicken wings? Y'all are? Awesome. Okay, and but today is the Super Bowl of caring as well. And we also wanted to make sure we realize that even though we're going to get to have a fun time tonight, whether the Falcons win or lose, hopefully they'll win. But realize that a lot of people don't have the luxury of being able to have all the things we have. And so we need to give and really be appreciative of what we have.
Who knows what you do with soup? You eat it? Yeah. We are collecting cans of soup, and at the end of the service, when everybody's going out, there will be people with pots, and if everybody can put $1 into the pot, then we'll have a lot of money to help and give food to everybody that needs it. So if everybody could put $1 in, that would be really helpful.
Okay. Dear Lord, please let us enjoy tonight and enjoy the game and enjoy the fellowship that we will have with all our friends and family. But please let us remember that we are very blessed by what we have, and that is the best thing for us to give to others that don't have it. In your name we pray. Amen.
With what shall we come before the Lord this day? We come with a love of justice and a passion for sharing Christ's love. Let us walk in humble gratitude, offering to God a portion of the gifts that God freely shares with us. So let us now give back to God of our tithes, gifts, and offerings.
Let us pray. Lord God, we pray that you would receive this offering we bring today, that it might be fitting in your sight, that it might be used for the work of your church, both near and far. Lord, make us cheerful as we give. Help us to be filled with your Spirit in all that we say and in all that we do. These things we pray in the righteous and risen name of Jesus Christ, our living Lord and Savior. Amen. Please be seated. Just put on the chair. Yeah, you put on the chair. Yeah, right there is mine. Yeah. Our reading from Scripture on this morning is from Paul's first letter to the church at Corinth, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Listen for the word of God. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human, except the human spirit that is within? So also no one comprehends what is truly God's except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God. This is the word of the Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God. When I was a small child, I think I was 3 years old. I might have been on the early side of four, but when I was really small, the church that my family attended at that time up in North Carolina got a new minister, a man my parents really, really liked and respected a great deal during his time of service at that church. And though I don't have any direct memory of it, I was too young, I've heard my mother say that on his first Sunday in the pulpit, this new minister spoke these as his very first words to his new congregation. He said to the congregation, he said, "I have decided to know nothing among you except Christ Jesus and him crucified." A mother says that she turned to her father, who was seated on the pew right beside her, and whispered in his ear, "I think we've got us a preacher." So many ways, Paul's theology really is a theology of the cross. He knew that the gospel he proclaimed was not something that was self-evident to most people, if anyone. In fact, quite the contrary was true. It was foolishness according to the wisdom of the world, this supposedly good news that God's Messiah, God's chosen one, was executed by the Romans in the vilest way imaginable, and that God wants those who follow Jesus Christ to suffer for the sake of the gospel like he did. The path of salvation through the cross of Jesus Christ was far, far from being a no-brainer for much of anyone. Suffering servants didn't make a whole lot of sense on face value to most people. It did seem to many in that Greco-Roman world in which Paul lived to be more like bad news because it didn't promise a better and easier life. It seemed more like a crown of thorns than a rose garden. One of the things that Paul frequently had to deal with during his missionary journeys throughout the Mediterranean world was to deal with the prevailing wisdom of the community in which he found himself. And in the city of Corinth, right smack in the middle of ancient Greece, the prevailing wisdom of people was usually found in the words and the thoughts of Greek philosophers. Most of those philosophers were more human-centered than they were God-centered. They were concerned with personal enlightenment, personal fulfillment. They were based upon human values and human assumptions about what is good and what is moral and what is of benefit to us as human beings. And while the influence of the early Greek philosophers, people like Plato and Aristotle and many others like them, is an undeniable influence and is really foundational in the history of Western thought and philosophy, it is not, in the end, wisdom that leads us to God. It is not the best thoughts we have expressed by the brightest minds in our world that show us the path to salvation. Rather, It is the cross, the wisdom of God. Wisdom that seems to be foolishness to the world at large. Sometimes we really do deceive ourselves about all of this. We try to soften the blow of what is implied, what is profoundly expressed at the cross, the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died. There are many churches that attempt to soften the blow. Churches that teach what has come to be called a prosperity gospel. The emphasis with prosperity gospel is always on the bounty of the harvest and not on the long hours spent out in the sun tilling and planting the soil. It's a gospel that makes reasoned statements and handpicks certain passages of Scripture to prove its points, to back up its claims that God wants to make our lives easier, better, that God wants us to have the good life. God wants us to have the things that we want, both material things and things that are related to our status in this world. In times so filled with negativity, many people are drawn to that sort of teaching. It's a positive word that doesn't beat us up all that much about our sinful state. It may be looked at as a glass half full sort of theology where grace is fairly cheap and where blessings are abundant. That is what sounds like good news to so many people these days. And there are churches that preach this prosperity gospel that are filled with people every Sunday. They have police officers directing traffic in the parking lot. They got so many people coming, and some of them are even on national television. But Paul believed something quite different. Paul believed that the content of the gospel itself, the self-giving act of God at the cross, had a power, has a power unto itself. And though it seemed to be foolishness to the world, Paul kept on preaching it because he knew that the gospel has a power unto itself, that is the very wisdom of God, and that isn't comprehensible apart from the Holy Spirit in our midst. The wise of the world will never, ever fathom it. But it is the message of God's saving act in the person of Jesus Christ, God's only begotten Son. Paul believed that content is a whole lot more important than style. Now, that certainly is a counter-cultural notion in these times that we live in. Some years ago, I remember a commercial for one of the big camera companies that featured tennis star Andre Agassi, and he was hitting shots and he was snapping pictures, and the slogan of this commercial stayed with me. It said, "Image is everything." Now, they were talking about selling cameras, I realized, but that phrase, "image is everything," is something that characterizes the ways that a lot of people live their lives today, doesn't it? Maybe even you and me sometimes. But Paul said image means nothing if it's meaningless. He believed that substance always trumps style. And it may have been precisely this issue that was on his mind as he wrote to those divided followers of Jesus Christ who were at Corinth at that time, the divided church that was there. There is truly some evidence that Paul may not have been the best preacher around. And even though his letters, these wonderful letters like 1 Corinthians and Romans and Philippians, even though those letters stand as some of the most profound and certainly some of the most influential Christian writings of all time, perhaps the most influential, Paul's skills of oration may have been a little bit substandard. It even says as much in 2 Corinthians. He admits that he didn't come to them with all kinds of lofty words, all kinds of plausible words of wisdom, but he came knowing nothing at all except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Apollos may have been a little bit better preacher than Paul was. The book of Acts says that Apollos was eloquent and well-versed in the Scriptures. And there are all these debates about some belonging to Apollos and some to Paul and some to Peter. And so maybe Apollos' style had led some of the Corinthian Christian people to believe that Paul's authority to Apollos was secondary, because Paul wasn't as good a preacher as Apollos was. And so it led ultimately some to say they were of Apollos And some to say they were of Paul, and this grieved the Apostle Paul, who had founded that church there, and it likely prompted the writing of the letter itself of 1 Corinthians. But again, for Paul, it doesn't matter, because it's the content of what he preaches that really matters. It's the apostolic word entrusted to him by God, and he preaches it no matter how scandalous it may seem, no matter how poorly received his message may be by the general public, because it is the wisdom of God, even if it seems to be foolishness to so much of the world. Paul could no sooner have quit preaching the gospel than he could have quit drawing breath. And we know that he suffered beatings, numerous beatings, and jailings, and even shipwreck in order to spread the gospel in that quest that he had to spread the news that he knew because of his faith to be good news. It seems to me that our observance this morning of the Lord's Supper, as it does each and every time we gather for it, at some level reminds us of the crucified Christ as we partake of the elements that we understand at some level to be his body and his blood. This practice we call a sacrament is one that wouldn't make a whole lot of sense to participate in if someone was not a follower of Christ. It may even confound us sometimes if we really think about the implications or of what is meant by the Lord's Supper. It's something that we ponder theologically for all of our lives. It is an ancient practice of the church dating back to Jesus and his disciples in the upper room. And as we commune, we truly are handling the mysteries of God and nothing less. It's an overwhelming thing for us at some level. And yet we observe it. We observe it each and every month, first Sunday of the month and at other times, and we observe it without any reservation because Christ commanded us to observe it and to do so because we are the people of Jesus Christ. This do in remembrance of me. And we do it also because the Holy Spirit attends to us as we do. And the Holy Spirit helps us to experience communion and to understand it in some way that is spiritually meaningful to us. We observe it because the Lord's Supper contains a spiritual reality that we can only understand through the eyes of faith. None of us here today, not a single one of us here today, used our own wisdom to reason ourselves to God. Instead, we are called by the grace of God to simply believe and to trust in the power of the gospel. And so we profess belief in God's scandalous word of grace, that Jesus was crucified, dead, and buried. Of course, we also profess God's scandalous and ultimate word of grace that on the third day he rose again, and that is truly an ultimate word of victory. But it always comes through the way of the cross. The path of life that was walked by Paul and by the other disciples, the path walked by all of those who say they follow Christ. He is risen indeed, but first, he suffered, was crucified, dead, and buried. And he did it all for you and for me. This is the heart of the gospel, says Paul. The very embodiment of the wisdom of God, the truth of all truths. The Son of God came into the world to be a suffering servant and a suffering Savior. It is still, and I suppose always will be, a word of foolishness to so many in this world. It doesn't make sense, and it never will. And yet the mysteries of God run deep. And it is only by our faith that we understand what it is God is trying to tell us and how it is that we are to live our lives to the glory of God, the one from whom all blessings flow. Amen. We come to this table on this morning. We gather around it, called to it as we are by God, commanded to observe it as we are by Jesus Christ. It is a sacrament. That is to say, an outward and visible way of expressing something that is an inward and spiritual grace. And so it is that our taking of communion is something that we do without fully understanding it, without understanding all the implications of what it means to do so. But we do receive it as a gift from God, the one from whom all blessings flow. So let us taste and let us see that the Lord is good. Let us now join together in singing our communion hymn, hymn number 101, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Now to join with me in professing our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed that are printed in your bulletin. Let us say together what we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Holy God, creator of heaven and earth, with joy we praise you and give thanks to your name. For you commanded light to shine out of darkness, divided the sea and dry land, created the vast universe and called it good. You made us in your image to live with one another in love. You gave us breath of life and freedom to choose your way. You promised yourself in covenant with Abraham and Sarah, told us your purpose in commandments through Moses, and called for justice in the cry of the prophets. Through long generations, you have been faithful and kind to all of your children. Great and wonderful are your works, Lord God Almighty. Your ways are just and true, and therefore we praise you, joining our voices with choirs of angels and with all your faithful people of every time and place who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We praise you, most holy God, for sending your only Son to live among us, sharing our joy and our sorrow. He told your story, healed the sick, and was a friend of sinners. Obeying you, he took up his cross and died that we might live. We praise you that he overcame death and is risen to rule the world. He is still the friend of sinners. We trust him to overcome every power that can hurt or divide us and believe that when he comes in glory, we will celebrate victory with him. Remembering all your mighty and merciful acts, we break bread and share one cup, giving thanks for your saving love in Jesus Christ. As you raised our Lord from death and call us with him from death to new life, we give ourselves to you to live for him in joy and grateful praise. And so let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. By your Holy Spirit, bless this bread and this cup that they may become for us the presence of Christ among us. Share your light and your love on the offering of our lives. Draw us together into one body and join us to Christ the Lord, that we may remain his glad and faithful people until we feast with him in glory. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we praise you now and forever, Almighty God. Amen. On the night that he was betrayed, our Savior took bread, blessed it, and then broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me."
And in the same way, our Savior took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins. Take it and drink it, and do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's saving death until he comes."
Thank you.
Please join with me in our unison prayer of response. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us and fed us with the richest of blessings. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us now sing our final hymn of this morning's worship service, hymn number 371, Lift High the Cross. Please stand if you are able to do so. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.